What did your students say about presenting, Gada and Eric, about presenting there at the conference? Were they excited? Had they the opportunity to present before?
The undergrads? Yeah, it was their first time. So they were, you know, a little nervous going in, I think. But they were, they were excited about it and enthusiastic.
Yeah, my student wrote one of her memos, the last memo, instead of doing a co-tutoring, she like used the conference event for that. And she said it was like the best field work hour. she learned a lot, and she, like, it helped her get out of her comfort zone. At first, and once we get into it and find our momentum, it gets better, you know.
That's awesome. Very nice. Great. And they are already tutoring. Are they tutoring already?
So in 390, the students get the employment letter or offer letter, and they start tutoring in the fall semester. But they do like mock tutoring, like kind of like co-tutoring, observations. I think with Eric, it's different, right, Eric?
Yeah, I think both of mine have been tutoring for, you know, about 10 weeks or so, roughly, at that point. So
that's
their first semester, but they've gotten a few sessions under their belts.
Okay. So thank you very much. Olga, Jorge, Manuela, thank you very much for being here. I'm sure that others will be joining us later on. I will start by introducing our presenters today in this week of artificial intelligence at the School of Languages. I will start with Gada. Gada is a PhD student in rhetoric and composition at Purdue University. She's an assistant director of undergraduate education at the Purdue on-campus writing lab. Her research interests are focused on tutor education, disability studies, and comparative rhetorics. Eric Joseph, he is a writer and a musician from New Jersey, currently pursuing a PhD in rhetoric and composition at Purdue University. He holds MFA, that's a master's, fine arts in creative professional writing from William Patterson University. His research focuses on writing centers and the material and psychic barriers that prevent first year and first generation college students from seeking the help of academic and mental health support services on campus. He's also interested in ways students, writers communicate and self-diagnose mental health and illness. So once again, I am very glad that you could be here with us, sharing your experience as tutor educators, sharing the work that you do with ChatGPT, with artificial intelligence in the context of writing centers and tutoring. The floor is yours. You can present now, and thank you very much. That's it.
All right, thanks for the introduction. So I guess, Gada, I'll share the screen like we talked about.
That'll be great.
Make sure I have this set up right. All right, so. Can't tell what I'm sharing. Sorry, hang on. Oh, now it's popping up. All right. There we go. The screen I wanted to share wasn't showing up, but now it is here. All right.
Thank you so much, Eric. Again, thank you so much for having us today. We would love to share our you know, research and work on tutor education curriculum at the Purdue OWL. As Carlos mentioned, we both work at the Purdue OWL as tutors, but also assistant directors. And much of our work is involved in tutor education. So today we wanna, you know, present on this topic of tutor education curriculum as it relates to ChatGPT writing. And we're gonna talk about some ethical considerations. In terms of our overview for today, Eric, can you make sure to?
Yeah.
Thank you. So we're gonna, you know, individually discuss you know, or we will cover today, like how we usually train tutors at the on-campus writing lab at Purdue University. Generally, there are two routes to tutor training. One is the traditional one. It's the one we've had for years, English 390. It's the practicum for tutoring writing. This is, you know, one route that tutors can take for training. The other one, which was developed a few years back, it's the newer approach to tutor training. It is the self-paced curriculum, or SPC. Eric is gonna talk more about that later. Besides, you know, the tutor training, we're gonna share how we designed and conducted training units on ChatGPT from each of our curriculums. And towards the end, we will, you know, we would love to have a conversation and address any questions or thoughts you have in the Q&A portion. When we presented this back in the conference, we had a Q&A with our undergraduate students, but they could not be here. So we're gonna, you know, make sure to, you know, voice their thoughts as well, and make sure that we can talk about that, you know, from their perspectives as well. So you can scan the code if you want to access the slideshow. You can also use the URL. I will also copy paste that in the chat. Oh, okay. And we also have another QR code. This one is for the, let me make sure I also copy paste that. This is a code you can use to write in any of your thoughts or questions during the presentation. We're very into like collaborative Q&A. So, you know, we would love to talk about whatever you're thinking and address your questions at the end of the session. So there's that too. I also copied that in the chat. All right, thank you, Eric. So here we go. All right. So in my portion of the presentation, I will be talking about the tutor training unit that I developed for my English 390 course. So a bit of background. I currently teach Purdue OWL's practicum for tutoring writing, the English 390. As I mentioned, it's one of the training routes that students take to become undergraduate writing consultants. And the course is highly interactive. We meet twice a week to discuss theories and dynamics of writing consultation and examine tutoring practices. So students get a lot of hands-on experience about how to approach writing and tutoring. They also spend time in the OWL. They familiarize themselves with the space, and they also conduct fieldwork hours, which means they get to observe other tutors and co-tutor, you know, with the, you know, in their sessions. So as an instructor teaching students how to become writing consultants and not feel as though ChatGPT and all the, well, any AI writing tool, you know, can replace their own writing and work, I designed a training module for one of our weeks to talk about AI tools, tutoring, and ethics with my students. In terms of the rationale, I wanted my students to first critically reflect on how AI tools like ChatGPT affect learning, their learning, and their own writing. And I also wanted them to imagine how to utilize or use this AI tool in their own tutoring sessions. And third, I wanted to consider how ChatGPT has certain possibilities, but I also wanted them to reflect or consider the limitations it has in writing-centered work. So in my lesson plan, I wanted my students to kind of think about ChatGPT and what's going on, and you know, form their own opinions about it, and also feel empowered when it comes to handling or working with AI technology. And in terms of objectives, I wanted the week's lesson plan to go as such. So we had 2 days, and the lesson plan, with the lesson plan, I had the certain objectives. The first one was I wanted students to become equipped with an understanding of how ChatGPT works to begin with. Especially that most of my students actually said they haven't tried it before. So I also wanted them to experiment with ChatGPT and think about its usability, its purposes, and also critique writing content that is generated by ChatGPT. And then also reflect on the role, the possibilities, and the limitations, as well as ethical limitations of using ChatGPT in writing-centered work. The first thing we did, in terms of the lesson plan, before students can, come to class, and in preparation for this kind of lesson plan, students were assigned reading material about ChatGPT. I really chose the recent material on ChatGPT from different outlets, from the news, a podcast, an opinion piece. So for example, the first one was a podcast episode from one news outlet about how there's a high price to pay with ChatGPT. The second one was an opinion piece that discussed whether ChatGPT can be a tutor or replace a tutor when it comes to writing assignments. And the third one is a two-pager from Writing Across the Curriculum organization on addressing AI tools in writing. So they read these three materials before coming to class. The next thing they had to do in preparation for class is to also submit a discussion post about their experience with ChatGPT. So I asked them to choose a past course assignment that they did and insert the assignment prompt to ChatGPT. And in their post, they needed to compare the paper they wrote for this previous class versus the paper produced by ChatGPT, and to note 3 points of observation about their writing. The first day we met, students talked about their experiences with ChatGPT. And for their privacy, I will discuss their collective responses and emotions towards this new AI tool they were trying. So I won't be disclosing what they wrote in the actual discussion board posts and the collaborative Google Docs we did. Instead, I mentioned the following. So in their responses, my students noted that ChatGPT has potential to grow. It could be helpful in things like outlining, brainstorming, connecting ideas, especially for second language learners. Some of my students noted that. However, my students, for the most part, didn't think that ChatGPT was that great. They argued that ChatGPT cannot really produce truly creative work, nor can it deeply and rhetorically critique the way humans do. It also lacked depth and character. To them, at the end of the day, it was a fun tool, but it was just that, it's just a writing tool and can't really generate a connection with an audience or a client at the writing center the way a real writer or a tutor would. In terms of the second day, after we did that, on the second day of classes, my students were presented with 2 copies of a conference proposal, and they had to guess which one was written by ChatGPT. I didn't tell them I wrote one of the proposals. I chose a very rough draft of my proposal And they were paired up in groups to annotate the proposals before giving out their opinions about, you know, which one is ChatGPT generated and which one was not. So when my students voted, all of them except one thought the conference proposal I wrote was generated by ChatGPT. Their faces dropped when I confessed that it was not. Partly because they were certain like only a robot could sound very like concise, direct, and have, you know, use words like can't, for example. So it was somehow an interesting moment, because in my head I thought, should I be worried or happy or sad that my students think that the proposal I wrote was one produced by ChatGPT? And I asked myself, you know, did my academic tone as someone who does not speak English as a first language sound like ChatGPT? So I asked my students what they thought this meant, and they confessed that it was a tough decision to make. They kept going back and forth because of the way the writing sounded. And in the second half of this class, my students brainstormed ideas on how to ethically proceed in the face of AI-mediated technologies when tutoring. In a collaborative Google Doc, they focused on addressing the following question. One, can or should we use AI in writing-centered training or tutorials? If so, what can it be used for? And two, how would our learning as writers be different if we used ChatGPT? What about our tutoring? What would that look like? My students argued that they would not promote ChatGPT in a session, in a tutoring session, unless their client brings it up. They believe there's value in the interaction between tutor and client, something that ChatGPT can't really replace. They said that if a client brings up ChatGPT, my students agreed that they would have a conversation with their client about the ethical issues with ChatGPT, such as plagiarism, and provide information for the client to understand more about the using ChatGPT as a writing tool, especially that some clients might not be aware of its drawbacks or limitations. When my students talked about how learning to write would be different if we all used ChatGPT, they highlighted how ChatGPT cannot replace the human writing process. AI tools focus on product, while we as tutors discuss the process of writing and engage in creative work with our clients. They thought ChatGPT might trump budding writers and limit their ability to generate ideas, original ideas. It was remarkable to see that my students were not really scared or intimidated by ChatGPT. They acknowledged the nuances of writing now that ChatGPT was in the picture. However, they didn't really feel threatened about their professional future as writing consultants. Even with the ChatGPT as the newest trend, this lesson plan made me realize how important it is to open up students to the complexities that ChatGPT brings to the table. ChatGPT does not need to upend our modules for tutor education or our writing, for that matter. Instead, it could innovate how we train our tutors. We need to remember that ChatGPT can't really replace interpersonal communication and rapport that is built into tutoring sessions. ChatGPT can't substitute client-tutor interaction, though it could help facilitate the conversation. As tutors and administrators, it's important to foster institutional awareness around AI tools and understand its influence on academic writing across the disciplines. Students might be using AI tools anyway, so we might as well guide them on how to use them both strategically and ethically. That's the end of it. I give the floor to Eric.
All right. So I'm going to take over from here for a little while. So basically what I'm going to do is just start off by giving an overview of what the self-paced curriculum is, which is what what I'm implementing at the OWL. And then I'm going to talk about a specific module that I designed and taught to get tutors experimenting with AI. So the self-paced curriculum is something that we developed so that we could recruit tutors from a wider variety of disciplines and backgrounds. So specifically, one of the issues that we were coming up against historically was that STEM students were having trouble fitting the practicum course, which is the course that Gata teaches, into their academic plans. So basically, they didn't have enough room to take extra electives. So there was a strong need, to meet the we wanted to meet the demographics of the demographics and like majors of students who come to the writing lab as best we can. So there was a really strong need for us to kind of figure out a way to do that. And interestingly, like this process started before I started here. So one of our predecessors, or two of our predecessors actually, had sort of started it, and then I took it over. They handed it off to me once as they were moving on to other positions. So the self-paced curriculum really helped that meet that need for recruiting a broader range of students. So tutors who participate in the self-paced curriculum, they clock in and out like any other tutor, while working at their own pace through a sequence of, right now it's four modules designed to introduce them to just some foundational conversations and composition theory. The number of modules is really, if you were to implement something similar, you could, of course, implement however many modules you want, basically a little lesson plan kind of things. So the students, they also gain, as part of this process, the last module that they go through as part of their main, like, basic training is they do at least 7 hours of hands-on tutoring experience where they run real sessions with experienced writing tutors. And then once they complete this sequence, they're able to begin tutoring. And on average, this takes about 4 to 7 weeks. We've had people finish it sooner or a little bit later. But that's kind of, 4 to 7 weeks is really like what it's been averaging so far. And then we also have some continuing education that we implement in a whole really wide variety of ways, and a lot of people are involved. So if they finish up with time to spare in the semester and start tutoring, I have extra continuing education that they can do just as a continue, just right along with their self-paced curriculum. So I usually get a few hours off the schedule to work on that each month. So that'll cover sort of like special interest topics related to Writing Center work, like accessibility type things or identity-based things. But we also have one of our associate directors does like multilingual or translingual learning. That's like a semester-long thing. That would be like their second semester. One of our tutors also runs essentially like a reading group where we read like book chapters and articles and just kind of meet informally to talk about them. And those will be on just whatever is kind of going on in writing centers, or sometimes it'll be like a historical writing center article. So it's really, the self-paced curriculum fits in, like I'm kind of giving them the basics because there's so much elsewhere for them to also get. And the module I'm going to talk about today specifically, again, it deals with AI and writing. So as I designed this unit, I really wanted to encourage discovery and exploration. Just because I think those are values that work really well with the self-paced format. Just because there are no deadlines or grades. So, it just kind of gives them room to explore a bit. And I wanted tutors to discover also, kind of for themselves, like what are the strengths, limitations, the ethical dilemmas of involving AI in the writing process. And I wanted them to articulate a working definition of good writing in the age of AI. And to sort of just ask themselves, like, is the way that I think of good writing, do I need to update that definition or not because of what AI can or can't do? And beyond that, I also just wanted to encourage tutors to engage in play as a meaning-making activity and to actively put them in the role of researcher and teacher. So like, you know, I really tried to reinforce with them that I, you know, going into this, like I was not positioning myself as an expert on AI. So I really wanted in that way, just to encourage them to like take that sort of, you know, responsibility and agency in their, you know, in our knowledge making in the writing lab. And so the module itself, it's divided into four steps, and I'm just going to run through each of those four steps. So first, tutors articulate their current definitions of good writing. Second, they develop a writing prompt for ChatGPT to respond to, and they reflect on how the AI handles different types of instructions. Then third, they respond to ChatGPT's writing as if it were a client at the lab, and they evaluate its strengths and weaknesses. And then finally, tutors revisit their definitions of good writing that they wrote in step one, and they brainstorm ways of using AI in tutorial sessions. So as tutors develop their preliminary definitions of good writing, I was really happy to see that they would often point back to our course readings and other previous activities that we had done. And that, you know, this is something that I encouraged them to do it in general, but I didn't explicitly require them to, you know, to connect back to previous assignments. They just kind of did that on their own, which I thought was really great. Because I think it shows that the self-paced curriculum is sticking in their head in some way. It's doing something. And as I read the responses, I found that I was informally sort of coding or sorting them along like two different spectrums. So on the one hand, we have like writer versus audience as like one theme that they kept returning to. And then content versus style was sort of another, you know, way of thinking about what is good writing that they also kept returning to. So writer-dependent criteria spoke to how the writer feels, how they express themselves, and on coming to an understanding of their thoughts on a given topic, which one tutor connected back to one of our readings by Malcolm X, which is, I don't know if anybody saw from Writing About Writing, but it's the piece that's in there. And then audience-dependent criteria focused more on addressing the writing prompt, accomplishing the paper's goals, and on understanding the rhetorical context. Then moving to content concerns, those dealt primarily with having something meaningful to say. And while stylistic concerns, they dealt more with how the writer says it. And then, so that's just, you know, that's sort of how I like broke up, like, you know, sorted in my head, like what they were talking about. And then while each tutor stressed different aspects of writing, I found that they all offered really like sophisticated and holistic perspectives on what actually constitutes good writing. And then as tutors developed the writing prompts, they identified a really broad range of strengths and weaknesses with the AI. And a lot of them are really similar, you know, if you kind of read through them on the slide, a lot of them are really similar to things that Goddess students found, but I'll kind of run through their highlights too. So they really, you know, one thing that they said was that ChatGPT was really good at simulating good writing, that, you know, they used a lot of words that kind of got to the idea of that it was simulating, like simulating was a theme that they kept returning to. They didn't all use that exact word, but it was like thing, you know, kind of synonyms for that. And then, you know, they found specifically it could compile facts and information from, and, you know, represent like really a variety of perspectives, but it couldn't really make decisions. So, you know, one example a lot of them ran into is that they couldn't get the AI to choose its own position on a topic because, you know, they were, you know, I asked them to get the AI to write a persuasive essay, and they couldn't get it to kind of choose a position. It would just kind of write informatively over and over again, unless they like told it what position to take. That was the workaround that a lot of them came to. And it really just like wasn't able to like sort of synthesize or draw connections between ideas. It just sort of like information dumped. It just said things. So in a way, I think like part of what they really got to was that like the AI is like sort of, I don't want to use the word neutrality because that's kind of, you know, I don't think it's truly neutral, but its neutrality, for lack of a better word, was its biggest weakness, even though, you know, in some ways that is a strength. And I thought another thing that was really interesting was that, you know, sort of despite thinking that the AI's writing was fake or simulated, a lot of the tutors in their responses, when I asked them to, respond to the tutor at, or to the AI as if they were, in a writing session, a lot of them, they would critique it pretty harshly, but then they would, in their responses to me, they would say like, I feel really guilty criticizing it too harshly. So they were sort of like anthropomorphizing the AI, like as if it could, as if it had feelings, like it still felt in some way human to them. And I think that's really interesting because I think it really like shows the level of, how much they care and how much empathy they have for working with writers, which I think are, just really encouraging to me. So then as they arrived at some sort of their final definition of what good writing is, given what AI can do, they had a pretty wide variety of responses, and some of them arrived at like a really fundamentally altered notion of good writing, whereas others were just kind of like, yeah, I know, like, I think my original definition was good, and it just like kind of reinforced what they thought. And as an instructor, I think that's really good, just because like they're being honest with what they think, and I think that shows that they're engaging, in a level where they're not just giving me the answers that they think I want to hear, which is sometimes a thing that students do, right? Like, they weren't just sort of like appeasing me or whatever. So I think, that made me feel good as an instructor because it showed some level of trust. The big takeaway for me was just that like, despite the variation in their responses, tutors tended to say that ChatGPT would like check the boxes of good writing, like on a rubric, for example, but that it just didn't really produce writing that was engaging or thought-provoking, which were like engaging and thought-provoking were like really themes that they really, those were things that they just kind of collectively thought were really important about good writing above everything else. And I just, in terms of like whether or not we should use AI or ChatGPT or other AIs in writing, in tutoring sessions, they didn't really feel strongly that it, that it would be helpful, and, or that we should try to implement it. Again, like they gave a lot of the same, they identified a lot of the same strengths that Gatta students did. Like they said it could be helpful for brainstorming or for proofreading or, maybe for like multilingual writing in some way. But they sort of, it was just sort of like, yeah, like we could use it for these things, but we don't really want to. Like that was kind of the tone that they took, even if they didn't explicitly say that. Even as they identify strengths and imagine potential applications, they express ethical concerns related to authorship, in addition to the sort of just doubt about how effective it would be, and they stress the importance of human connection, which I think is also something Gatta's students also found, and that they just really thought that the AI was unable to reproduce like that sort of real human connection, and I think it's really interesting that like my students and Gatta students like came to similar conclusions, without knowing each other or working together in any way. I guess we can move on to Q&A. The link that's up there, I think, is just the link to the Google Doc, right, Gatta? Yeah. Yes. So, do we have any questions in there yet, or?
Yes, we do. Okay, cool. I'm gonna copy the link recently.
Yeah, I'll stop screen sharing. Cool. I see a few more people logged in. That's cool. All right. So got it. Do we want to just go through the questions on the doc first, or do we want to start with some real live questions?
Yeah, I think I think we can start with the Google Doc, and we can do that first if that's a good idea.
Yeah.
So
you want to read the first one?
Yes, sure. So the first question is, how do you prepare yourself before presenting ChatGPT to your students? What advice would you give teachers to bring ChatGPT into the class? Would anyone want to say more about that, the question, or?
I was just wondering, you prepared all these, both of the units, wanting to equip your students with some technology, knowledge, cognizance, but how did you prepare yourselves? So I am an instructor, I am a teacher, I want to explore this in the classroom, in class with the students, I want to propose a task or a unit, as in your case, but what is the work I have to go through before presenting that to the class, to the
I think it's
I was just gonna say, I think we might have cut out right at the very end of the question, but we got all of it.
Okay.
You go first then.
Awesome. So in terms of preparing for this module, I had to honestly think about why I'm doing this lesson plan to begin with. Honestly, I knew that, ChatGPT had been out for a few months. There had been a lot of faculty panic around the topic, especially in writing center listservs. Some faculty were starting to experiment with ChatGPT, seeing what it can produce, kind of gauging the possible pros or usages or even limitations. And kind of prompted me to, sit down and say, okay, I need to also start looking to what ChatGPT does. I had always, seen folks around me use it, and for me, I was like, I don't think I need it. Kind of, that's just the mentality I started with, before this whole thing. But, I think it's really important to start experimenting with it yourself as a teacher, and kind of figure out your own responses to it, your own reactions to it, and even having conversations with other faculty about it. What I also did, I don't know, maybe this is strange, but I actually tried to look up the interviews of the CEOs for ChatGPT and kind of saw what they were talking about when it came to ChatGPT and the public's view, panic, oh, this is gonna substitute jobs, this is gonna change the way we write. So I needed some popular opinion, but then also academic opinion to get me thinking about it. And when it came to the lesson plan, I just I mentioned the learning outcomes, so I wanted students to actually try it out themselves. Most of them hadn't, because for them, most of them are kind of they belong to different majors, some in STEM fields, some in education or languages, but they were all super confident. They were like, I don't think I need to try it, or I tried it out of curiosity. But when they, I thought it was important for them to try it within as writers and tutors. So they needed to put themselves in that mentality and say, oh, as a writer, many of them were frustrated when they saw that ChatGPT could produce writing in just mere seconds, while they took so many hours and days to produce stuff. So it got them thinking about what this like technology means. So in terms of preparing, like I also needed their reactions to it. I also needed them to try it. And then for us to actually like, you know, I wanted them to look at what policy statements out there in relation to writing is saying, like the AWAC one, what they thought about AI writing tools, to get kind of like a policy statement, and then more like writing samples. I want them to look at writing samples by ChatGPT so they can actually critique it. So it really depends on what you're looking to do with your students and what you want them to understand, like at the end of the day. Because as Eric said, like we had similar responses because they were really thinking about like, oh, how will I use this as a tutor? If I come across a client who sits down with me and says, my, ChatGPT wrote this for me and I want to edit it with you, or I want to revise it. So how do we negotiate those things without total panic or telling them like, no, you cannot do this. Like we want to make sure that, we are preparing our students for conversations about ChatGPT and for better ways to handle it. So these are my 2 cents on the.
A lot of what I would say would, you know, I would reiterate a lot of what you said, and also just add, something that I really thought about, along the lines of like, God is, you know, sort of why am I doing this lesson plan, is like, what do I want to know about ChatGPT? What don't I know? Just as sort of like, you know, I'll just say like your average writing teacher, like, what don't I know? Because the things that I don't know, I think are also things that other people don't know. So that's my starting point. And like, I played with it enough that I like sort of could see what it would do, and like could, I familiarized myself enough with the tool that I like would understand how it worked and like what it, you know, what its functions were, but I didn't want to like know too much about it. So like, I didn't, for me personally, for my assignment, I didn't want to position myself as an expert. So I sort of intentionally, like I didn't engage in like too much scholarship on it. Like I didn't like dive into that because I wanted to be able to position my tutors, like I wanted them to be the experts on it and to teach me as if I knew nothing about it. From reading their responses, and then like from there, I use their responses as my starting point of like, you know, this is what my tutors are saying. Like, what are other people now saying as I sort of, you know, open it back up? That was how I approached it. It certainly doesn't mean that everyone should approach it that way. I would just add that. I think that's pretty much. Oh, you know what I wanted to add? I wanted to say also that something I did, because my tutor training is implemented asynchronously for the most part. What I did was I made sure they had just links to enough resources where they could get like, the website is called, OpenAI dot whatever. They have like a sort of how to use this tool guide. So I linked them to that. I gave them, I think I linked them also to like a resource on like, I think I found like a how to guide and like how to use AI, how to use ChatGPT to like write your high school essay or something like that. I gave them that as like a helpful thing. And actually out of that, what's really interesting is like since then I've been getting a lot of ads about like, either like AI, like, what's it called? For this one, like essay writing service I keep getting ads for now. And their whole thing is like, don't use AI to write your essay, use us, cause we're better at it. Besides the point of the question, but I thought it was a funny thing that I was eager to share. Got anything else to add to that, or do you want to look at the next question?
Thank you very much. Very clear.
I think we're good. Do you wanna go to the
Yeah,
I probably remember not the first one, but
yeah. So okay, so the second question we have is, what does the tutoring portfolio contain? Yeah, so I guess Gada and I both have tutoring portfolios for our students. I think they're relatively similar. Mine is basically they do, I think, 7 observations total. So we have 3 types of tutoring, right? We have, the traditional in-person face-to-face, we have online like video chat tutoring, and then we have online e-tutoring, which is like the, submit your paper and we send it back to you kind of thing. So we have those 3 versions of tutoring. And basically the first thing I have them do is I have them just be in a tutoring session as a student. So I just have them, they have to basically just like, whatever they're writing for another class, just bring it into the writing lab as if you're a student, get tutored, and just tell me what it was like afterwards. So that's one, that's the first thing they do. Then they do their observations. So that's where they watch each of the 3 session types happen. And then after they do those, they do what we call co-tutoring. So they run the session where another tutor, a more experienced tutor, kind of watches them do the session and gives them feedback afterwards. So it's sort of like, riding a bike with training wheels and lifting the training wheels as you go along. That's how I think about it. So it, kind of eases them into tutoring slowly and gives them some, increasing responsibility as it goes along. And in terms of the actual portfolio, they just write a reflection of what it was like doing those sessions. For me personally, I don't give them like any length requirements. I just kind of say like, I have some questions to kind of get them going, but I really emphasize with them that like they don't have to answer the question directly. It's just like, tools to get them started. So I get a pretty wide range of like what their final submission will be. But like, more times than not, it's like more times than not, it's too long rather than too short. So that's totally fine with me. I haven't encountered anyone like giving me too little. And if they were to, I think I would just sort of, talk to them and be like, what do you think about this? How'd your sessions go? What do you think about them? So I kind of just let them submit what they want to in a way. I also let them, if they want to, they can submit like a verbal or video recording of themselves. If they, are just like, I'm writing in all my classes right now. Like I kind of let them like approach it in different ways. Because ultimately I just care about like what they're learning more than anything. So yeah. God, what about you?
So yeah, it's very similar to your approach, Eric. The thing is though, because English 390's practicum is a course, it's a 3 credit course. And so it's like 16 weeks. We spend time together 16 weeks twice in class. So with the tutoring portfolio, it's kind of like longer. So because they're not tutoring right away, it's not they go through the self-paced and then they start tutoring in the same semester most of the time. In my case, they have like 14 hours of fieldwork hours, or which means that they basically, the first hour is when they go to the lab and just familiarize themselves with the space, the tutors, the front desk, and the team, all that. And then, they start observing, they interview some tutors. So the hours accumulate until at the very end, they're co-tutoring and then they're independently tutoring. So just to get them, growing as tutors and becoming confident. And, at the beginning of classes, we talk about what they did. And it is very similar to Eric's, where they write, short like memos or journal entries about their experience doing each fieldwork hour. And at the end of the semester, they submit a tutoring portfolio, which contains their resume, because we practiced that during, like, you know, the class. I was like, why not? Like, it's as though they are applying for this job. So they submit their resume. They also give a letter of intent, which means they express why they want to work at the Purdue UL, like what skills did they gain. So sort of a reflection, but more within like a professional like genre of like letter of intent or cover letter. And then they compile all their fieldwork and journal entries and any informal writing they want to do, just so that they're giving a portfolio that represents them. Some of them, you know, kind of implemented it in their personal websites, or they did kind of like a video cast of it or something. So it was kind of interesting to see what they would do with it, because I want them to use it as like a professional, you know, like paperwork that they could later present. And it's very similar to like how with Eric, it's the same thing. So yeah, that's how the tutoring portfolio works.
Yeah, I would add, you know, some of the other things that Gada talked about that like I didn't mention that my students do, like, you know, coming into the space like early on, like my students also do some other stuff too. It's just, you know, earlier assignments. I don't include that in their tutoring portfolio. So there is a lot more that they also do other than just those, observations and co-tutoring sessions. I think the main difference is like my students, they're already hired at the lab. Whereas Gada's like, they get, you know, possibly get offered a position after they complete the course because they're getting course credit for it. So it is a pretty different, a different circumstance, a different situation for the student to be in. So we do approach a few things differently just based on that situation.
I have one more question. Yeah.
So how does ChatGPT or other AI influence, for good or bad, because we did see some good and bad, the development of writers' identities, positionalities, or informed opinions? That's a good question. Gada, do you have thoughts right away? Or
I can go. This question actually reminds me of what some of our undergraduate writing consultants or students, they said about the creative writing or the process of writing that might change if, you know, if early writers or you know, writers, especially when they're learning to write in different languages, how it might affect the learning. And I guess we still like don't know, like we don't have like concrete evidence of how it's changing like a writer's learning development and whether it's in their first language or a different language. But, you know, one of my students said something interesting. They said like, you know, if right off the start, a writer is just using ChatGPT to generate ideas for them, to brainstorm for them, there's something lost there, like in terms of their the creative like first stages of writing, because writing is not just, hey, this is the product. There's so much that goes, with that, from like brainstorming, revising, talking to others about writing. And obviously writing helps with learning because, you know, students learn how to critically reflect, think, formulate their opinions about who they are or what they care about or whatever writing piece reading material they encounter, like they formulate all that, and writing helps with that. And I think like ChatGPT might trump that at some point. However, we also see on the flip side, there's writers who say, okay, I am feeling stuck and I'm not sure how to express this, whether it's in my language or in other languages. And I kind of use ChatGPT to write prompts for me to get me started on writing. So I you know, there's like, there are two sides to it. And I think if we just like make sure that students are, if they are using it as part of their writing process, they are aware of the ethical like considerations of it, like what counts as plagiarism. We are having conversations about that in class or in curriculum generally. But then also having them use it responsibly, having them use it, well, okay, if it's becoming a writing tool, surely like Grammarly or Writefully, I don't know how many, there's so many out there, but this one's like the fastest, like language, biggest language model generator, whatever, that, you know, has beat all the rest, right, as of now. So just making sure that they are using it responsibly, you know, as well. I don't know if that's helping to answer the question. But yeah, I think it has the potential to influence both positively and negatively at the same time, right? It's just a matter of like reminding our students, like, this is why writing, like this is the stages of writing. This is why you write. This is who you write for, like the audience, the context. And AI doesn't do that, just replicate or just like, builds up together words. It does not do like, doesn't write rhetorically, and humans do. So that's kind of also another thing. Yeah.
Yeah, I think, you know, just sort of like, as long as writers are approaching using AI, if they choose to, from a position of like still asking questions, and like work, you know, using it as a way to work through their ideas and, you know, maybe to see perspectives that they hadn't considered on their own. I think that can be really helpful. As long as it's not just like, you know, with anything else, like, as long as you're not just sort of taking what's in front of you as fact, I think you're good, as long as you're still asking those questions, like, you know, what do I think about what I'm being presented? What do other people think about it? And how can I like work through like this complexity? You know, that's what I would be thinking about, is how does this help me navigate complexity, and like, what am I bringing to the table?
Especially like, because AI is not accurate. The ChatGPT is not accurate. It sounds accurate, but doesn't mean that the information we are presented with, or like the sources that are, you know, presented to us on ChatGPT are correct. There might be some that are, some are not, but you know, that's besides the point. It's the fact that there's a limit to it at some point. And I think like writers need to think about, okay, like where can this tool help me, but where is this tool also limited and how it's helping me, and where it's not generating like actual facts or informed opinions, right?
Yeah. Do you have any other questions or comments, anything?
Thank you very much. What about the audience? Valentina, Andres, Alejandra, Alejandra Torres, Olga, Manuela, anybody?
I just want to say thank you to Beda and Eric. This was very interesting, and it was very, how do you say, como ameno? I don't know.
This was very kind, cool. Interesting, entertaining, yes. Yeah.
Yes, enlightening. Thank you so much. Yeah.
All right, Gada, Eric, thank you very much for your time. I know your work. I know that you are very, very busy. Faculty, people, you have a lot to do during your everyday. So I really, really appreciate that you separate and allocated time to be with us today and share all the work that you have been doing with your students at the Writing Center. And we were very happy to have you here and getting some of that you are doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Carlos, for having us. We really appreciate it. It was really fun.
Yeah, thank you again for having us.
All right. Bye bye. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Bye.